living creatures we're most closely related to are chimpanzees and bonobos, and we share 99% of our DNA with them. They are more closely related to us than they are to gorillas. So the animals that you go and see in a zoo, chimpanzees and bonobos and gorillas, two of them are more closely related to the people who drive cars and buy ice creams at the zoo than they are to the other sort of animal in the zoo. We are most closely related among the living animals to chimpanzees and bonobos. If we compare their DNA with our DNA, molecular biologists tell us that the differences probably took between 6 and 8 million years to accumulate. That leads to the hypothesis that we shared a common ancestor with chimpanzees and bonobos. We have changed a lot in the 6 and 8 million years. I mean, that seems a long time, but in terms of evolutionary history, it's a very short time. We have changed our posture, we have changed our diet, we have changed the extent to which we rely on cognition to be successful. So a whole lot of things have happened in those 6 to 8 million years. Human evolution researchers like me want to know what happened in that 6 to 8 million years. And the only way we can do that is to find evidence of the creatures that were between that common ancestor and us. And this evidence is either in the form of fossils and what those fossils look like. In the relatively recent past, we also have evidence from the genome. So that's a new thing. And so we look for evidence of creatures that are more closely related to us than to chimps and bonobos and gorillas. And that forms the basis. That's the evidence that we work with. But this is a little like trying to reconstruct a traffic accident when you have no witnesses, no skid marks, and the only parts of the damaged cars are tiny bits of scraps. That's unfortunately the business we're in. So we work on pretty slim pickings in terms of evidence, and we have to guard against the temptation to overinterpret it. There are times when there is more than one sort of animal alive that we think is either our ancestor or our close relative. Now, if you're alive today, the only thing you have to have is ancestors. You don't need close relatives. And I have a picture of my great-grandparents' golden wedding, and everybody in that picture, apart from my Aunt Kitty, is an ancestor of mine. My Aunt Kitty was a lovely lady, but she wasn't necessary for my existence. And so we try and sort the fossil species that we find, which ones are the equivalent of our parents and grandparents, and which ones are the equivalent of my Aunt Kitty. We assume that the more morphology you share, the more likely you are to be an ancestor. But it turns out that sometimes, because organisms are living in the same habitat or similar habitats, they develop independently the same solutions to living in those habitats. So therefore, shared morphology is not always equivalent to shared ancestry. Modern humans is just one species. There are hardly any groups where there's just one. And the problem is, if you just have one living animal, you have nothing living that you can usefully compare it to until you get to a chimpanzee and a bonobo. If you go back 50,000 years, modern humans were sharing the planet with Neanderthals, with Homo floresiensis, with the Denisovans, and probably with at least one other species which we have evidence from DNA, but we're not sure what it looks like. There are some differences between us and chimps and bonobos that are sort of counterintuitive. We are very dexterous. We knit, or if you're lucky, you can play the piano and the violin. You would have thought that means we have more muscles than in our hand than chimpanzees and bonobos, but we don't. We have many less. So actually what makes us dexterous is losing muscles, not sort of gaining muscles. The exception is that we have an extra muscle in the thumb, and that seems to have made all the difference. Human brains are about 3 times the size of the brains of our closest living relatives, the chimpanzees and bonobos. But they are not only larger, but weight for weight, they're more expensive to run. So our large brains are also expensive to develop. So our large brains are like a sort of luxury car. They cost more to buy, and once you've bought it, they cost more to insure and to run. And so there has to be a really good reason for us to have a large brain. These extremely costly brains, you would have thought that by now we would have come up with a really good reason why they are large. But we don't have a sort of one compelling reason. Some people think that once we changed our diet to include meat, this allowed the brain to enlarge. Some people think that increasingly complex social organizations required large brains for you to remember all the people that you have some interaction with. Some people think that the development of complex objects that requires you to understand the various stages in the process, they think that would have been facilitated by a large brain. But my sense is that there is no one explanation. The estimated genetic variation in the whole of modern humans is less than the observed genetic variation in a relatively small group of wild chimpanzees. How can that be? Well, the only way it can be, because we shared a common ancestor and we have been accumulating genetic variation in a clock-like manner ever since, is that for a period of our evolutionary history, there were very few of our ancestors. And that reduction, it's called a genetic bottleneck, reduces the accumulated genetic variation. And so the only genetic variation that makes it through the narrow neck of the bottle is a relatively small amount. And it's been estimated that within the last 100,000 years, modern humans were down to maybe an effective breeding population of 10,000 individuals. We nearly didn't make it.